No miracles needed next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman. The book, it's brilliant, No Miracles Needed, How Today's Technology Can Save Our Climate and Clean Our Air. It's by Dr. Mark Z. Jacobson, Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering and Director of the Atmosphere Energy Program at Stanford University. It's a follow-up to his book, 100% Clean Renewable Energy and Storage for Everything. And No Miracles Needed is an energy and climate landmark. Welcome, Mark.
Well, thanks, Carl, for having me on again.
Your last book, great, but mainly was a textbook. This is a book for everybody. Let me read how the book is described in its opening page. The world needs to switch away from using fossil fuels to using clean, renewable sources of energy as soon as possible. Failure to do so will lead to accelerated and catastrophic climate change, loss of diversity, and economic, social, and political instability. This book describes how to solve the climate crisis and at the same time eliminate air pollution and safely secure energy supplies for all without using miracle technologies. It explains how to use existing technologies to harness, store, and transit energy from wind, water, and solar sources to ensure reliable electricity and heat supplies. Chapter one in No Miracles Needed starts with the question, why do we want to transition all of our energy to clean, renewable energy? Why don't we just continue burning fossil fuels until they run out? And Mark, you provide three major reasons. The air pollution tragedy is what you call it, global warming, and energy insecurity. Let's go through all those three major reasons, Mark.
Well, worldwide, 7 million people die each year from air pollution, and hundreds of millions more are ill. And of the deaths, about 20% are children under the age of 5 years old. And these are avoidable deaths. 90% of them are due to energy. But this book also talks about how to address non-energy sources of pollution, such as biomass burning as well. And so air pollution, it's a solvable problem. And if we eliminate emissions from fossil fuels and biofuels today, that air pollution problem will be solved pretty much tomorrow, because these are not long-lived pollutants. These are short-lived. They only last in the atmosphere, you know, a few days to weeks. And climate change is the second major problem that I'm discussing, we're trying to solve in the book. And global warming it's a problem that's gone on for a long time, and it's going to get worse and worse. Already we're at about 1.2 degrees Celsius global warming since the 1850 to 1900 period. We're trying to avoid 1.5 degrees Celsius warming. And we can do that by eliminating or transitioning 80% of our energy to clean renewable energy by 2030 and 100% by 2050. Alternatively, if we delay that, then we can get to almost 2 degrees Celsius global warming. And there are many, many problems associated with these higher temperatures that we don't have time to go into, but they're including sea level rise and famine and increased air pollution, more severe weather and more severe storms like hurricanes and tornadoes and droughts and floods and shifts in agriculture, as well as losses of coral reefs and more. And then energy security is the third major problem. And you know, fossil fuels are limited resources. They will run out at some point. And when that happens, if there's no alternative in place, we will have economic, social, and political instability. In addition, not only that's the one type of energy insecurity, but also some countries control the energy of other countries. And as a result, like we see in Europe right now, there are now shortages of fossil fuels in some countries, which on one hand has actually created a massive growth of renewable energy. But the fact that, you know, that's one thing, if every country provides its own power, its own electricity and heat for all purposes with clean renewable energy, then we don't need to rely on international transport of energy so much. Not to say that some international transport of, let's say, transmission lines going between neighboring countries is not advantageous economically, it is, but it really reduces the amount of energy insecurity due to one country controlling the energy of another country. Anyway, those are some of those are all the three problems that we discuss in the book.
And then in chapter two, you titled WWS Solutions for Electricity Generation, with the WWS standing for wind, water, solar energy. Let's go through them, please.
The generation technologies that we already have that we propose to use on a large, large scale are onshore and offshore wind, solar photovoltaics on rooftops and in power plants, concentrated solar power, and also solar heat for some purposes, geothermal electricity and heat, large-scale hydroelectricity, which already exists. We don't propose new large-scale hydro, also small-scale run-of-the-river hydropower, and also tiny amounts of tidal wave power if those become economically viable. So those are the generation technologies that are summarized in Chapter 2.
And there's a variety of other sources that you cite. Could you just speak on, there's an abundance, there's a bonanza, in fact, of renewable energy sources. And your book just goes from one to another to another.
Well, I try to lay out so it's, you know, people can see that we have the technologies that we need. So we have onshore and offshore wind, solar on rooftops and power plants. We have geothermal electricity, geothermal heat. We have hydroelectricity. And we even have tidal wave, although those are still more costly than the others.
You deal with WWS solutions for transportation, too, including for trains, trams, streetcars, trolleys, light rail, and you go on to aircraft and marine vessels. Speak about that, please.
The main types of transportation in the future under this plan would be mostly battery electric vehicles, but also some hydrogen fuel cell vehicles for long distance heavy transport, like long distance aircraft, long distance ships, some long distance trains and trucks, and some long distance military vehicles, but otherwise be battery electric. And so, yeah, we can transition everything. We have examples of most all the technologies we need already. I mean, there are even electric aircraft today. There's some hydrogen fuel cell, but they're all short distance aircraft and hydrogen fuel cell aircraft. We have some electric and hydrogen fuel cell ships, but we really need to ramp this up to a larger scale. We have 95% of all the technologies we need. I mean, the ones that we don't have right now but we know how to do is our long distance aircraft and ships primarily, but some industrial processes.
Also, your book deals with heating and cooling. Describe what you point to in regards to heating and cooling, please.
Buildings require, most of the energy in buildings is for either hot water, hot air, or cold air, and also some refrigeration. There's lighting as well, and electricity used for appliances and machines. But that heating and cooling, I mean, most of it today is from a fossil fuel, mostly natural gas, or burning wood pellets or burning oil in homes. But, you know, heat pumps, electric heat pumps are much more efficient than natural gas or any type of combustion heater. They use 1/4 the energy on average. And so the idea is to put heat pumps in all homes for not only air heating and air conditioning, but also for water heating, and even heating clothes drying. It can be done with a heat pump dryer. These use much less energy because they don't create heat. They just move heat around. And as a result, they use 1/4 the energy as natural gas.
Now, getting back to the start of the book, on that first page, it's noted that the book also discusses which technologies are not needed, including natural gas, carbon capture, direct air capture, blue hydrogen, and nuclear energy, nuclear power, the latter being certainly promoted these days. The claim is nuclear power could deal with global warming. Could you go through some of these, wrong directions?
We want to eliminate three problems simultaneously. So we need to focus on technologies that solve all three problems. And part of the problem today is there's a focus on climate alone, and that allows for some technologies, several technologies, in fact, that actually increase air pollution and increase energy insecurity and hardly reduce even any carbon. For example, natural gas. I mean, natural gas is thought of as a bridge fuel between coal and renewables. However, natural gas emissions are very high in terms of not only its combustion emissions, they're lower than coal from the combustion point, but there's a lot of emissions with the upstream mining and transport of the natural gas. And just the emissions alone are, you know, from an air pollution and a climate point of view, are just much, much higher than wind energy or solar energy. So, and also we have energy insecurity due to fossil fuels. So continuing with natural gas does not solve any energy insecurity problem. Similarly, carbon capture added to a power plant, you need a lot of money for the power carbon capture equipment, and you need a lot of energy. And like 30%, if you put carbon capture on a coal plant, 30% of the energy from the coal plant needs to go to run the carbon capture equipment. And let's say even if you use renewable electricity like wind power to run the carbon capture equipment. Well, first of all, carbon capture equipment only takes CO2 out of the exhaust stream of a coal plant. It doesn't take out any other air pollutant. So let's say you use renewable energy to power that carbon capture. What if you instead use that same renewable energy to replace the coal plant itself? Well, the exact same amount of wind, for example, to replace the coal plant. Not only do you decrease more CO2, but you eliminate the air pollution from the coal plant, you eliminate the fuel mining of the coal, and you eliminate the coal infrastructure. So the social cost benefit is just enormously better to use renewables to replace a fossil fuel plant than to run carbon capture equipment. The only purpose of carbon capture equipment is to extend the life of a fossil fuel plant of some kind or another, or some kind of fossil fuel entity. And it's just it's such a drain on society because of the fact that you can, you know, even if you use renewable energy, which is the best case for carbon capture, that renewable can be much better used to actually just replace a fossil fuel plant. Direct air capture, same thing. You're just taking CO2 out of the air and it needs a lot of energy. Why not use that exact same, let's say it's renewable energy to replace a fossil fuel plant. Then you eliminate more CO2. You eliminate the mining of the fuel for the fossil fuel plant. You eliminate the fossil infrastructure and you eliminate air pollution. So you get about almost up to 10-to-1 social cost benefit ratio. Direct air capture, it's the same thing. It's just natural gas producing hydrogen with carbon capture on it. Same problem with carbon capture as regular carbon capture. It's much better just to, first of all, produce hydrogen with electricity from renewable energy. That's called green hydrogen, and not waste electricity to run carbon capture for blue hydrogen. Nuclear reactors, small modular is the new fad. They're not even proposed to be existing until 2030 as a prototype. But, you know, the problem with large reactors today is they take between 10 and 21 years between planning and operation. They cost on the order of, the new ones cost on the order of 7 to 8 times the cost per unit energy as new wind or solar. So new wind or solar, you can put up in half a year for rooftop PV versus 2 to 5 years for utility scale wind and PV. So why would you wait an extra 15 years to put up a power plant that costs 7 to 8 times more per unit energy when you can do something cheaper and faster? And that's not to mention all the energy security problems associated with nuclear weapons proliferation, meltdown risk. What do you do with all the waste for 200,000 years? You have to store it and pay money for storing it for 200,000 years. Underground uranium mining, lung cancers, and the fact that carbon dioxide emission equivalents of nuclear is actually about 9 to 37 times that of wind, because not only the life cycle emissions of CO2, but the opportunity cost, the fact that it takes so long to put up a nuclear reactor, you're putting a huge amount of carbon in the air in the meantime. Also, there's heat emissions from nuclear and water vapor emissions, and both of those contribute to warming of our planet.
Yeah, and the nuclear fuel cycle involved the enrichment and the mining, and the whole process is carbon intensive.
That's accounted for. And then there's also the underground, from half of uranium is mined underground. And, you know, historically, 10% of all miners have died of lung cancer due to radon progeny, namely polonium that gets in their lungs, and which is a carcinogen.
Now, in the book, you get into where the transition, to no miracles needed, to these sensible, available energy technologies are, in fact, just above your left shoulder, just behind you, is a piece you, well, was a piece in the Scientific American regarding your work. This is years ago. You've been very involved in the transition, and you spend a lot of, well, pages in the book talking about where there have been, and they're happening now, successful transitions to this kind of no miracles needed energy program.
There are 9 countries of the world that are 100% wind, water, solar in the annual average, and they're all primarily with hydropower as their main source of energy. They're also, even in the United States, there's South Dakota, it produces 126% of its consumed electricity from wind, water, solar, and 77% hydropower, 77% wind, and the rest being hydropower. It also produces some fossil fuels, and all the extra above 100% consumption is exported to other states. California, 2 days ago, last Sunday, was 100% renewables, 100% wind, water, solar for under an hour, but it was more than 95% wind, water, solar for over 4 hours, and over 80% for over 8 hours. And so we see larger and larger penetrations in different places. South Australia got huge penetrations of wind, water, solar, Scotland as well. And there are many more examples coming out every few months.
Now, you end the book by stating the main barriers to a conversion to wind, water, solar worldwide are not technical, resource-based, or economic. Instead, they are political and social. Could you elaborate on that, Doctor?
We have the technologies we need, and the costs have come down. And this is why we see penetrations, large penetrations of wind and solar, even in locations where there are no policies. Like in the United States, the locations with the most wind and solar as a percentage of their electricity supply are in states that don't have special policies. But we do have a lot of pushback by the fossil fuel companies. They are, you know, they're giving advertising bad things about renewable energy. There's a lot of competing energy sources, and like this blue hydrogen, the natural gas, carbon capture, direct air capture, geoengineering has even been pushed in some quarters, and bioenergy and small modular nuclear reactors. These are all technologies that are either not helpful, make some problems worse, or and hardly reduce carbon. Even if they are helpful for some purposes, they hardly do reduce carbon. And so there are a lot of lobbyists for these other technologies. And so even under the Inflation Reduction Act in the United States, a big portion of the subsidies are going for these technologies that we don't need. And so this is, so there's a lot of misinformation, but there's also a lot of lobbying. And there are, some people are just against renewables for some reason or another.
Well, as a journalist all my working life, I think a lot of this is an informational problem. I mean, you mentioned misinformation that people, well, that's why this book is so important. Here you're providing the information. You're providing a handbook for a renewable, livable future, providing the solutions. And in fact, we should just talk too, if we could, to the Solutions Project. And you were very involved with that. Can you just describe the Solutions Project and what it is doing?
The Solutions Project is a nonprofit that I helped co-found in 2011 with 3 others, Mark Ruffalo, Marco Craples, and Josh Fox. And the original idea behind the Solutions Project was to take these science-based plans that we were developing, well, and still developing at Stanford University, and try to educate the public and policymakers about them. And so really the idea is to combine science, business, culture, and community to advance these energy plans so that they can be implemented on a large scale. And so the Solutions Project did that quite well for a while, but subsequently it's transitioned some of its, or actually most of its goals to advance 100% renewables in inner cities and try to get people who are not necessarily haven't been engaged in 100% renewables to educate them about it, and also for people to propose projects, 100% renewable projects that will help humanity. So they're still doing great work. I'm not involved with them anymore, but I'm proud of what they've been doing.
Now, the closing line in the book is, when the 100% wind, water, solar solution is finally implemented worldwide, the air pollution and climate problems outlined in this book will be relegated to the annals of history.
I mean, that's a hope. I mean, hopefully I'll live long enough to see that day. But yeah, that's been my lifelong goal, and is to solve these large-scale pollution and climate problems. And just from the way I see it, you know, we need to focus on technologies that work, that we have in hand, that are cheap and actually very effective, and not waste time on technologies that are ineffective or cause other problems. And so I think we can solve these problems. We just need collective willpower among many people, well, all of humanity, in fact, to solve these problems. And so hopefully I play my small part in helping this process.
Well, importantly, in terms of your small part, and in fact, it's a big part, you come from an engineering background. You're not just kind of like fantasizing what could be. As an engineer, you've spent your life committed to workable solutions.
My whole career, I've spent trying to understand and solve large-scale air pollution and climate problems. The first part was to really understand deeply the problems and this, and like the interactions between gases and particles in the atmosphere. And this led me to understand why certain technologies, let's say bioenergy, for example, when you're burning certain chemicals, take ethanol for our vehicles, why, while it improves some of the pollutants in the atmosphere, reduces some of the pollutants, it actually increases others. So the overall effect is actually in some places to make air pollution worse than gasoline. In other places, it's a little bit better. But if you compare that with electric vehicles, you see a complete elimination of air pollution. So it's much better than both. But without actually having gone through, you know, the calculations and going through the science of understanding the problems, it's really difficult to come up with solutions that are really beneficial for air pollution, climate, and energy security simultaneously.
And at Stanford, your center at Stanford, you can describe its activities.
Well, so I'm a director of a program called the Atmosphere Energy Program. And this program really engages students to understand the atmospheric problems like air pollution and climate change, and also understand clean renewable energy solutions to these problems. So we try to ensure that students do spend time trying to understand the problems as well as the solutions so that they can make better decisions in the future.
Now, I'm speaking to you today from, and I mentioned before, your involvement in the transitional things that are occurring. Can you talk about how you got engaged in New York State, where I'm from, where I'm speaking from, too?
In 2011, I was approached at a dinner by Mark Ruffalo and Josh Fox and Marco Craples, and they were all working in New York, especially Josh Fox and Mark Ruffalo, to try to ban fracking, which is extraction of natural gas from shale rock, which was being done a lot in Pennsylvania nearby, but not yet in New York. So they were trying to get the governor of New York to ban fracking. But in order to ban fracking, it was necessary to have some alternative. And so they asked if I could develop an energy plan for the state of New York and as an alternative to fracking. And well, at first I just thought that would take up so much time and it would be a huge amount of work. I just said, well, I'll write one paragraph and maybe somebody else can take it on after that. But when I started writing that paragraph, I became very inspired. And overnight I put together a kind of a medium-sized New York energy plan. And that ended up, I mean, after like 35 more iterations of it and a year and a half later, it ended up as a published New York energy plan It helped, I believe, to ban fracking because the governor did ban fracking and the governor adopted a 50% renewable standard, which later became 100% renewable standard for the state. So that was, I thought, a major victory for humanity, especially the state of New York.
It's true. I mean, the 100% renewable goal in the state of New York, it's kind of a breakthrough in regard to government, but various governments, but you've worked with other governments too.
Yeah, I worked with the state of California, and California adopted 100% renewables goal. And in fact, in the U.S., there are now 19 states and territories that have laws to effectively go to 100% renewable electricity. Now, electricity is only one part of all energy. It's, in fact, it's about 20% of all energy. So we need to transition all that energy. And so there are some laws in various states to address other sectors aside from electricity. But yeah, I've discussed also internationally with different stakeholders in different countries. And there are many, there are 62 countries now with 100% renewables laws, and there are over 400 international cities and over 400 international companies that have passed resolutions to go to 100% renewables in their electric power.
I mean, that's utterly amazing. And just again, over your left shoulder, there in Scientific American, which is a pretty, well, it's a pretty traditional magazine. Can you describe the genesis of that front page article, Sustainable Future, about a sustainable future in Scientific American?
Well, in 2008, I wrote a paper evaluating proposed energy technologies to solve air pollution, climate, and energy security problems. And from that paper emerged these wind, water, solar options. And then in 2009, Scientific American approached me and asked, well, do you want to write a paper seeing if we could actually power the world with wind, water, and solar? And so I said, oh, yeah, that's a great idea. And I engaged Dr. Mark DeLucchi, who was at UC Davis at the time. And the two of us together wrote this paper on seeing if it was technically and economically possible to transition the world to 100% renewables for all purposes by 2030. And, you know, it was pie in the sky at the time and nobody believed it. But retrospectively, and in fact, at the time, utilities thought it wasn't possible to get more than 20% electricity on the grid without the grid crashing. But we thought otherwise and had done some simulations otherwise showing otherwise as well. But in retrospect, so by 2017, you know, that whole paradigm of can we put 20% electricity on the grid was now being thrown away. And people are now saying, well, we can get 80%, but still not 100%. But even 80% was arbitrary because, you know, a few years later, then they changed that to 90%. And then in the last year, even NREL, the National Renewable Energy Lab, says, yeah, we can get 100% renewables. And so it's without the grid going unstable and at reasonable cost. And so this whole idea that we can't get to 100% renewable was a myth. And we said it was possible back in 2009, and now it's actually happening, but not as fast as we need it. It turned out that that goal of going to 100% renewables by 2030, and that paper, the Scientific American paper, turned out to be the scientific basis for what's called the Green New Deal in the U.S., which was a policy proposal to go to 100% renewables by 2030. But, you know, we really need more policies put in place for this to happen, as well as even faster action. Because although things will happen naturally over time, they are not happening fast enough. And so, you know, we really need to step things up, but we can. I'm confident we can, and we do have the technologies, and the costs have come down sufficiently. So it really takes a lot of willpower, though.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all your work, Dr. Jacobson. Thank you so much for being with us on Enviro Close Up.
Yeah, thank you, Carl. Appreciate it.
For viewers of the program, thank you for watching. I'm Carl Grossman.